So today's webinar is around or about in-room Wi-Fi 6, and that's specifically talking about the ECW215. First, I want to thank everybody for joining today's Ingenious channel. This is a channel webinar. We appreciate your time and interest. Like I said, I'll be covering in-room connectivity with the all-new Wi-Fi 6 wall mount access point, the ECW215. I'll try to do a live view to show you the actual hardware and some of the mounting pieces to the hardware. So kind of like an unboxing, but not 100% unboxing. So with that said, I will go ahead and get started. So my agenda today is to talk about benefits of in-room Wi-Fi, more importantly, AP placement. I think, also I should mention, Eddie Lee is also with us today in regards to this webinar, and we're both here for any questions at the end of the webinar as well, so I should mention that. What I was going to say is Eddie and I, the two big things that we typically run into are the placement of the access point. It's one of the most critical things in understanding overlap between the access points. So we'll be talking about benefits of in-room Wi-Fi, but we'll talk about AP placement first and why you wouldn't bring it into a room. Then I'll go into the product specifications, minimizing truck rolls, very important topic, I think, for a lot of people. And then some new cloud features that are coming out that are really, they were designed around the ECW215, but can apply to other access points. And we'll talk about that as we go into those. And then I'll open up for any questions, and hopefully we can answer all your questions. And if not, we'll try to follow up later with answers. Okay, so let's talk about the illusion of great Wi-Fi. You know, I've used this slide over the years because, you know, there's this, you know, anybody that's been in the industry for a long time, they know that, you know, you can't just look at the signal strength on your phone or your laptop and say you have a great signal. But early on, that used to be the case. So AP placement is really critical. Specifically in student housing, assisted living, multifamily units, hospitality like hotels, for examples, we need to take the access points, wireless access points, WAPs, whatever you call them, out of hallways, corridors, and they need to be moved where you're providing service to the client device, the wireless client device. So APs placed in hotel hallways as part of the reason we see problematic Wi-Fi in hospitality, student housing, etc., especially when the applications being used are in the actual room and we have more demanding applications that we're running with, you know, like a smartphone or a tablet or a laptop. Hotels or even property owners just, you know, in the early days, and I think this is still the case, and it's up to the managed service provider, the system integrator, to explain more, but hotels or property owners just want to add Wi-Fi to say they offered Wi-Fi. Integrators early on would put wireless access points in hallways, and they would walk the property with their laptops and see great signal and call it good Wi-Fi. And I think a lot of that is pretty much over now. I think there's more education around how to deploy Wi-Fi. You can find it on YouTube very easily. And any vendor that you talk to will give you best practices in regards to how to install it. We hope that they do. We try to do that as much as possible. So we want to take these access points that were at one point in the corridors or in the hallways, and we want to move them where your client devices are located. So just to give you a little more insight into some of the negatives of APs in the hallway. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time on the subject, but just a high level of why you shouldn't be deploying in hallways and corridors. First and foremost, there's co-channel interference, interfering with one another. APs should not be in line of sight of one another. You want to try your best not to have the AP physically see the other AP. That would be like a best practice. You want to put it like around the corner or far enough away where it's not going to interfere with one another. So you really have to be careful of that. One of the greatest barriers are restrooms. So when you walk into maybe a dorm room or more so in a hotel, the first thing you run into is a bathroom that's either on the left-hand side or the right-hand side. That becomes a RF barrier. So you just want to be aware of that. And then deploying APs doesn't really make sense because really no one is working in the hallways. They're in the room. So why provide, you know, your APs in a hallway, for example? So you want to keep those out of the hallway. Other negatives in regards to APs and hallways is you have a low signal noise ratio. There's major coverage holes where Wi-Fi is needed, which is in the room. Typically, when you're deploying APs in hallways, you're not designing it for capacity. You're designing it for coverage. To back to the illusion of coverage, right? Or a great signal. When you put APs in hallways, it doesn't do any good for anybody that's in the room. In addition to that, you have poor rooming decisions when the access points are in the hallways as well. And there's, if you can imagine, all these ceiling mount access points are omnidirectional antennas. So lots of omnidirectional antennas in the hallways is a really bad mix for bad Wi-Fi. So there's some a couple images I found just online showing different deployments. You'll see this last one is our EAP350, I think it is, somebody deployed. I remember the comment being the Wi-Fi is great, but I can't believe they deployed the access point in the hallway in this manner. So, you know, maybe an inexperienced owner or a system integrator put this in, or an installer put this in and, you know, looked at their laptop and said, oh, this is great Wi-Fi. It's going to be great in the hall, or it's going to be great in the rooms. But, you know, that's the mistake that we typically see. So we want to get out of this idea of having access points in hallways and like I said, get them into basically the rooms where the devices are. So let's talk a little bit about in-room. Right now, I think we can estimate about 3 devices per user, maybe even more. And for a room, probably 6 devices, wireless devices. So this is not counting IoT devices like smart TVs, thermostat, devices operating in the room, or other devices that need to connect either wireless or wired within a room. And this is where our solution really comes into play. And that's why you want to bring it into a room. So you want to provide Wi-Fi where it actually matters. So make sure to implement wireless where it's needed. The closer the wireless client is to the access point, the better the performance will be for the end user, the better the experience will be for the end user. So you want to move those access points or design multi-unit developments or multi-unit dwellings with the APs in the rooms. Now, I should say this, it will depend on the environment, but you do not need access points in every room. It can be every other room. It just really depends on the construction of the building. If you're dealing with really, really thick walls, then potentially every room. Or if a single room is very large, like a suite, for example, that has multiple rooms, then one in every room. But if it's a small type of hotel, you could potentially have one access point share a wall on the shared wall to the other room, have it mounted there, and it will provide Wi-Fi for both rooms. So just be aware of that. We're not necessarily saying every room. It depends on the environment, the construction of the building, and that will determine your placement. And you can do that with a Wi-Fi site survey or using like our Easy Wi-Fi Planner to understand that better. So place the APs as close to the client devices as possible. Minimize obstructions between the AP and the clients. You want to make sure you facilitate client devices' ability to talk actually back to the access point. You know, our access points can travel really far because we can amp up the output power of the radio, but the end device, the client device, like a cell phone, for example, cannot communicate back. So you want to facilitate the client device's ability to talk back to the access point. So shortening the distance, having less obstructions between the AP and the client is what you want to do. place neighboring APs so they're not in line of sight of each other. So you're minimizing co-channel interference with other APs on the network, and you can actually maximize channel reuse in large installations where you have a lot of access points. You know, we're limited on the channels. We're extremely limited on the channels on 2.4, which we typically don't use 2.4, where a lot of times we're using 5 gigahertz, where you have more channels to use. So you can reuse, you know, if you're configuring static channels, you can reuse channels by altering through the property. So you want to be able to maximize channel reuse, and you can do that by not having these APs in line of sight of one another. So there's some best practices we'll talk about on this slide. So best practices are staggering APs horizontally and vertically. You want to avoid hallways, as we already discussed. Do not stack floor to floor. You want to space out APs evenly so you have really good overlap. You want to allow for static and uniform transmit power settings. We run into this a lot of times where users will, or installers, system integrators will amp up the power on some APs and not on others. You want to try to be as uniform as possible. You want to simplify the channelization process as much as possible as well. And you want to use building construction, meaning like walls, corners, to isolate neighboring APs so they can't see one another. You want to avoid mounting behind obstructions such as like above the ceilings, or near duct work, for example, or pipes, Eddie, any other things you can think of. Like there are a majority of the things that I would not mount close to. Maybe lighting, that would be another thing I would throw into that. You always want to follow good wiring and mounting practices as well, so you want to keep that in mind. You can actually see on the right-hand side, I believe this is Tamograph that was used for this design, but you can see on the left when you place the APs in the room, the coverage area is where you need it, where the wireless client devices are located. So, you know, red is bad, blue is very little interference, white is low interference, orange is low RSSI, red is low RSSI. Green is good RSSI, that's anywhere from a negative 30 to a negative 40. Yellow is a good RSSI as well, and that's a negative 50. So you can see that the coverage is in the room where you need it. And so, I think this was done on Tamograph some time ago in a hotel deployment that we've done in the past. So these are some of the best practices that we use, among other things. And like I said, it really depends on the environment or the environment where you're installing the hardware. So let's talk about Ingenius's solution, our Wi-Fi 6 access point. We do recognize and we do understand there's huge demand for wall mount access points, specifically Wi-Fi 6. We hear it probably every day now. So let's talk about what's coming down the pipeline very shortly, which is our ECW215 or 215. This is a cloud managed access point. I'll just highlight some of the specs on this particular device, and we can talk a little more in depth about that as we go through this. So it's a dual band 802.11ax or Wi-Fi 6. It's a 2x2. It supports theoretical speeds up to 1.2 gigabit on 5 gigahertz, 574 megabits on 2.4. That's obviously a theoretical speed. This is a pretty sleek low profile design for in-room Wi-Fi and wired connectivity. You can see that there's multiple ports. There's a port on the back, which is LAN 1. And on the bottom of the actual access point, you have LAN 2 and then LAN 3. And then there's a port, a DC input port. Please note that these access points do not come with a power adapter. They do not come with a PoE injector. You would use a PoE switch. In most cases, you're doing a large deployment with these access points, so you're going to use a 48-port switch to deploy these types of devices. So the actual access point has an onboard 2-port switch, which offers VLAN support or 802.1Q VLAN support. So it's port-based, so you can put VLANs on those particular ports if you need to. Like I said before, LAN 1 and LAN 2, they support 802.3AFAT PoE input. so that you can install these using PoE. So you can install these from a PoE switch up to about 100 meters or 328 feet from that particular device. So the port on the back, which is LAN 1, you can supply power to the access point, or you can use LAN 2 to power up the device. So it really depends on kind of the scenario and the environment again. Port 3, you can actually connect and power up a voice over IP phone or other PoE device with PSE support. So we do provide that third LAN 3 provides PoE out to a voice over IP phone. There's two new features that are coming out. One is already available, which is called smartcasting, to really personalize in-room media with mobile device streaming to a TV. And we'll talk more about that feature in just a moment or in a few minutes. Another new feature is extending the SSID settings or the configurations to the LAN ports, so you can provide captive portal, splash page, and advanced security on these extra ports, meaning port or LAN 2 and LAN 3. So you can actually copy the configs to the actual ports, and we'll talk a little more about that. All of our access points, including this particular access point, does support meshing. Eddie and I, typically, we don't like to use mesh as much, but if you're in a scenario where you have to use it, you can use meshing. You can mesh on 2.4 gigahertz. You can mesh on 5 gigahertz. Some of the things that come up when we talk to customers is maybe a new front lobby, for example. They put an access point up there for their guests. When they come in, they have Wi-Fi. They mesh that unit to a unit that's plugged into the LAN, for example. So that's where that scenario typically comes up, or a historical building or a historical hotel. So those are some of the reasons why we run into mesh. But we typically want every access point to be wired. Let's talk about the physical installation of the access point. A little disclaimer, I did not physically install this. Our FAE, Peter, installed this particular wall plate in our office for testing purposes. The access point comes with two plates. There is a short plate and a tall plate. We removed, in this first shot, we removed a standard wall plate, which already had mounting holes. We simply put our plate over top of that and mounted this. The access point, if you had an Ethernet drop, you would actually run an Ethernet drop and you would plug into the back into LAN 1 to power up the device. Or in this case, what we did is we used LAN 2 to power up the device. This access point will simply snap into place to the wall plate. And, you know, you can see it installed. And you'll notice LAN 2, technically LAN 2, is being used to power up this device in this installation. LAN 3, we're using it for a printer. So just to give you an idea of what the installation process looks like, it's a very easy install. And so at this time, let me share my screen with you just a second. So I wanted to show you the actual hardware. So this is the blur on. This is the access point. It's the wall plate. It has two ports on the bottom. This is, I believe, this is LAN 2, LAN 3. This is the power. This is the back port. This, if you're familiar with the ECW215, it's a wall plate. This has aluminum cast on the back for heat, basically heat sinking. It's a very clean, small device. It comes with two plates. Okay, I'm going to fix that really quick. So we have the tall plate. The tall plate would be used for ceiling mount, for example. You could use this on the wall as well, but it's optional. So you can install this on the ceiling. The access point will snap right in play. The Ethernet would drop through the center here and plug into the back of the actual access point. And then we have the short plate. This is the one that goes on the wall. And it snaps right in. And so again, you can power it through the whole, you know, Ethernet through here, and you can power it that way. So again, this is the ECW215 front. There's the bottom with the ports, and then the back also with the ports. So let me get back to, all right, back to the presentation here. So you can expect from this access point to cover about 1500 square feet with Wi-Fi 6 coverage. We're running it in a large office. That office is about 700 square feet, I think. About 200 square feet. It actually goes beyond the office and allows other people to connect, but you can tune the radio. You can turn the radios down, you can turn the radios up, but always use best practices when configuring the radio side of things. As I mentioned before, this is a cloud-managed access point. Really, the Ingenious Cloud simplifies the process of configuring, managing, and monitoring and troubleshooting this particular access point. If I simply, you know, if I'm looking in the cloud and I click on access points, it will bring up an access point list, which I'm showing you. This is the dropdown with an AP list. This is my access point. It allows me to start from a really, really high level and dive down to a particular access point. And that's one of the beautiful things with cloud, is you can mass configure a lot of these devices, and you can manage, monitor, and troubleshoot these devices. In regards to troubleshooting, like I said, you can start at a very high level, such as the organization, dive into a particular network, and then dive into a particular access point. So here I'm going from the dashboard, diving into my AP, all my APs within the network, and then I can dive into a specific access point, and now I can look at statistics on that particular access point. So it starts, I'm able to start at a very high level and funnel down to a particular access point and see what's happening on the access point. And that really helps me in a couple of different ways. Onboarding the access points into like a hotel student housing, I can do that very quickly, get configurations done, and get them up and running very quickly. And I can onboard my clients really easily. But I can also manage and monitor these devices as well, and I can troubleshoot these devices. And when you start troubleshooting from a remote standpoint, what that means is you're really minimizing truck rolls. We were just talking to a system integrator probably last week. Truck rolls were running around $400 to $425 every time you made a truck roll, because you're sitting out a truck, especially with gas prices right now. You have that technician that's going out there, spending that time, the drive time, the time on site, and the time they're coming home. All that time can be minimized or eliminated with more tools within the cloud, and that's what we're trying to provide here. So with our system, you can actually look at hardware performance, throughput, and RF utilization. So you can actually see CPU usage of the actual hardware, memory usage of the hardware. You can actually look at throughput by band. So if I could change this by to 2.4 or 5 gigahertz, I can look at the throughput. I can look at the channel utilization by band right here. I can change it from 2.4 to 5 gigahertz. I can see if, okay, is this access point on the wrong channel? Should I change it to a different channel, a cleaner channel that has less channel utilization? And if this picture doesn't really give me a great idea of, you know, this is a high level view of, okay, is this a good channel or not? I can then look at all channel utilization, and then I can look at channel utilization by band, by actual channel, and by width, so by channel width. And I can see and run my mouse and see, okay, where's there a really clean channel? Can I put this on 80 megahertz? Can I put it on 40 megahertz? Can I put it on 20 megahertz? And really start to fine tune particular access points in regards to channels. And I can do this remotely. I don't have to drive there and have somebody configure this. I can do this all remotely. In addition to understanding how the device is performing, how the Wi-Fi looks in that particular area, I can also do speed tests from this access point to see what the speed is from here. I can look, I can do actual pings. I can ping the actual end user in a particular room if I want to. I can ping outward to a gateway or to maybe a switch that it's directly connected to, or if it's daisy chained, I can ping those particular devices within the network. And I can also run a trace route to better understand, okay, if I'm in this access point, what does the connectivity look like towards the end user and outward? And to get a better understanding of, okay, is there a problem with Ethernet? Is there some other issue that's there that I should be aware of? Again, without rolling out a truck. The last thing I would like to talk about is you can look at live client activity. Live client activity gives you a ton of information. It gives you real-time information about the client that's connected to the access point. More importantly, it's telling you what band it's on, what SSID it's on, the device name. It also gives you SNR, which is critical. You can see my iPhone was at a 62 dB. That is an excellent signal or SNR with an RSSI of a negative 34. And there was another Apple device that was online that was on 2.4. That was SNR was 52 with a negative 42. That is a really good signal. I can almost determine they're pretty much in the same room with the access point, and they should have good connectivity. And you can have your end user test the speeds. We typically don't like using speedtest.com, but in some cases, you know, this is something that if I know I have a good signal strength, I'll have them pull up and say, okay, just do a speed test, see where you're at, and to get an understanding of, okay, this is really good. You can do most work with a 50 by 50 connection. So really, a lot of these tools are for, minimizing those truck rolls. So before I go into the new features, I wanted to go into a quick live demo, if I can. And this is unrehearsed, so we'll see how this all flows. So I'm currently in my cloud account. Hopefully you can see my screen. I'm going to refresh. Probably have to re-log in. And I'm going to go into my own account, my personal account. And you can see I've one switch, two APs. I have 13 clients online right now. And what I wanted to talk about really quick is how to onboard the access point. The access point that I was showing you in my demo. The way I want to onboard this device is I just need to register the device. But prior to registering, because this is a live network, if I go to configurations and I go to my SSIDs, I have three SSIDs already configured. So any access point that I register to my account, to this organization, Slayman organization, and this particular network, it will take on these configurations, these SSID configurations. Each of the SSIDs can be configured in different ways. So if I add a new SSID, just to give you an idea, I can have different wireless configurations, such as the broadcast name. There's that smartcast I was talking about. I won't talk about that yet. I can broadcast on 2.4, 5, and 6. A quick note, I've noticed this talking with customers. Some of them think they're broadcasting on 6 gigahertz. You're not broadcasting on 6 gigahertz unless the hardware supports it. This particular device, the wall plate, supports 2.4 and 5. So I can choose, pick and choose what frequencies I want to broadcast on, security type. There's multiple things I can do within here. Bandwidth control, captive portal, splash page. Captive portal, just really quick, different authentication types, schedule Wi-Fi, and access control. So as you can see, I have three SSIDs that I have configured. So I want to add a new access point. So I'm going to go to my organization building icon down here, go to inventory, and you can see I have multiple devices already configured or added into my organization, and they're assigned to different networks. So I have two different networks. I simply can click register, and I can put the serial number in here. So I'm lazy. So I will attempt to use the app, and hopefully I will not. This will flow easily for us. If not, I will quickly abort. And so we have a live. Okay, we have a live demo. Eddie, just make sure you can see that. So I'm going to go to my CloudGo app, and I'm logging into my account. So the dashboard is going to look very similar. Let me hide the background really quick here so you can just see my app. Now I'm looking at my Slayman organization. I'm going to, let me just show you the dashboard really quick. This is the Slayman network. This is the one, you know, we have one switch, two APs, 11 clients now on there. I'm going to go back. The little plus sign down on the lower right, I'm going to click that. I'm going to register a device. It's going to go to my iPhone camera. When it goes right to my camera so we can see, and I'm going to, you can see the AP. It's going to hit the QR code. Boom. So I'm going to register the device. This is the ECW215. I'm going to go ahead and name the device. I'll just name it as is. I'm going to assign it to a network. Now I can skip this if I want to, or I'm going to assign to the network. I'm going to apply. And next, I'm confirming basically and set up. Finished. Now, all I have to do now is plug my access point in, and my access point will go, okay, let me check in with cloud, checks in the cloud. It says, oh, it's assigned to Brian, his account. It's assigned to this organization. It's assigned to this network. And it's ready to go. So let me refresh my screen really quick. Let's see if it shows up here. I don't even know if I had to refresh, but I'm refreshing just for the sake of doing it. Dashboard. So now I have three access points. And you can see that that access point is basically waiting. It's offline right now. I just need to plug that access point in, and that access point will become live. You'll see broadcast on channels. It will get a WAN IP, a LAN IP, and so on. So it's really, really that easy. Just to quickly go back to the dashboard, and then I will go to a different network. I will go to the Ingenious network. So there it is. I'm going to the US. This is the network we're broadcasting on right now. Let me go to my access points. HR department is where the ECW 215, this is a different one. If I hit that line item, let me minimize a little bit. It gives me some stats on the AP, but if I scroll over, I can go to the details of that access point. And this is the 215 running in our current HR department. I can look at logs, I can look at the clients, I can, under summary, I can see the different configurations. If I hit diagnostic tools, now I'm diving into this particular access point in this particular office, and it's giving me CPU usage, memory, throughput, and I can change that from 2.4 to 5 and even 6 if it's supported 6. I can run a speed test, I can do a ping test, trace route. Here's my channel utilization. I can do it on 2.4 and 5 gigahertz. I can do a new scan. And if I run my mouse over there, it will tell me channel utilization, Wi-Fi utilization, non-Wi-Fi utilization, total utilization. And then I can go to live clients. And currently there's no live clients on there right now. So when somebody joins this network, we'll see live clients. It will give me all that information I showed you on the PowerPoint. All right, let's get back to presentation really quick. So wanted to give you a quick demo. Hopefully that went well for you and it translated nicely on the webinar. So let's talk about some new features. These were really designed with the ECW 215 in mind, but this particular feature is called in-room smartcasting, or just smartcasting. Smartcast gives really hotels or multi-dwelling units the ability to offer casting or Chromecast, for example, within a room. So a lot of hotels are minimizing or attempting to minimize operating costs per room. So the way they're doing that is they're minimizing TV programming per room to reduce costs per hotel room. So guests now can use their personal accounts like a Netflix account and cast their favorite shows to a hotel room TV. The importance of this is it improves the guest experience. So if you walk into a hotel today, for example, so you go into a Best Western, and you don't want to use their programming on their TV, or you don't want to log into your Netflix account on their TV, you can use your phone, your tablet, or your laptop, and you can smartcast your Netflix onto their TV that's in the room. And what this does is it improves your overall experience. You're basically bringing your account in and Chromecasting it on the TV. But the really nice thing about this is you're keeping the guest login credentials private, your information private. You're just casting, you're mirroring what's on your phone onto the TV. So you're not watching it on this small screen now. You're watching it on your room TV, if that makes sense. Hopefully that makes sense. So the way we are able to do this is, you know, traditionally what you're doing is you're creating a hotel guest SSID. With the guest SSID, you're typically enabling L2 isolation to keep everybody private. So when I'm on the network with all the other guests, I don't see, nobody sees one another. So you have L2 isolation. In some cases, you have NAT enabled as well. Or even better yet, you have a VLAN that's enabled on that particular guest SSID. So you have this SSID that's broadcasting with layer 2 isolation. So how do you cast? If you have L2 isolation on, you won't be able to cast. The way we do it is we implement MDNS. MDNS allows for casting information to be passed across the network. So essentially what we're doing is you can now create a hotel guest SSID for all your guests to connect to. So your guests are connecting to this, they're safe, they can't see one another, they're safe on this particular network. And your smartcasting devices, meaning the TVs that are in the individual rooms, are wirelessly communicating to what we call as a smartcast SSID. And these particular TVs now have Wi-Fi access to the same access points that the guests have access to. And so your smart TV or your TV with Chromecast, a Chromecast device, can now connect to this SSID. What this allows the guests to do is to cast their information to their personal TV within their room. And they can do that through a QR code. The QR code can be either printed out and placed in the room, or the QR code can actually go on the TV. The guest walks in, scans the QR code, and is now able to cast to their particular TV. They won't be casting to somebody else's TV. They'll be casting to their TV within the room. And so this feature is now available within the cloud system. When you're configuring SSIDs, you can find this within that configuration, which you got a glimpse of when we were just talking about SSIDs within the cloud. So this is a new feature. It's active right now. And the purpose of it is to give your guest or the hotel guest the opportunity to cast their devices onto a TV. Another new feature is the ability to apply SSID configurations to specifically on the ECW215 on LAN 2 and LAN 3. And what you're able to, the configurations you can apply to LAN 2 and 3 are, you can leave the security type to open, or you can put it to WPA 2 or WPA 3. Enterprise security, I need to make sure everybody's aware of that, WPA 2, WPA 3 enterprise security. You can actually apply layer 2 isolation on these ports. You can actually block MAC address. You can message. We provide a service called Message for Block Clients. So when your clients are blocked, they get a message saying, hey, your MAC address has been blocked. This can be applied to those particular ports. You can apply VLANs to these ports. You can enable Captive Portal with advanced authentication to these ports. You can also allow VIP MAC address listing on here as well. So it's basically allowing gaming devices to onboard without Captive Portal. That's what our VIP service is within the cloud. You can enable NAT. You can enable bridge mode on these ports. You can redirect to URL with advanced settings for that. And then system reserve, when you're using NAT, you can change the IP range within our system using system reserve IP range to these actual ports. This will be launched in Q3, but you will be able to apply the SSID configurations to port 2 and 3. So two new features coming out. The other thing I would mention really quick in regards to in-room smartcast is, you know, it was designed for really the ECW215, but it can be applied to our ceiling mount access points as well. So just take note of that. So this can be deployed in multiple ways, but mainly for the ECW215 access point. I think that covers everything I wanted to talk about in regards to the in-room Wi-Fi, the installation, the AP placement, which is really critical. Why you want to have in-room Wi-Fi or place the access points closer to the end users, and what the new ECW215 offers to you and you to your customers. And what I'll do now is open up for any questions that you may have. So we'll open up for any questions. Eddie, if you can help me out with the question.
So are there any restraints school to stop someone from snapping it off the plate for the ECW215?
I would say no. It just clips right into the to the back. There is not a lock on there. No, on this version, there's no lock on that particular version. Normally what we find, and it sounds like you're familiar with the installation process. Typically it can be done behind the TV stand or behind a desk, which shouldn't disrupt the signal when you're that close to the access point. So you can install it that way, but no, there's not a lock on this particular access point.
Thanks, Mark. So is that model had DFS channel available as I saw on the screen?
No, this particular device does not have DFS. That is something that we're considering later. But yeah, there's no DFS. We find that if you properly do channelization in most hotels or multi-dwelling units, you should be okay.
Okay, there's another question here. Do you need to use the mobile device to set up this cloud network? I can use the smartphone to config multiple separate networks. So I think, Brian, you already answered. You want to add more?
Yeah, there's multiple ways to register a device. You can actually register the device through the cloud interface. If I just go to inventory and click register, I can type in the serial number here. I can actually copy and paste serial numbers here from an Excel spreadsheet. As long as the serial number is one per row, you can do hundreds at a time and you can register all those devices. They'll end up into your inventory and you can do a mass assignment to a network, or you can pick and choose and assign it to different networks, or you can use the mobile device. It's just really more preference.
Okay, is the 215 replacing the 115?
The ECW215 will eventually replace the ECW115. The ECW115 is a Wi-Fi 5 or 802.11 AC Wave 2 access point. The 215 is a Wi-Fi 6 or 11AX access point. In today's world, we're deploying 95% of the time, 90% of the time, we're deploying Wi-Fi 6. And that's what we would suggest. It handles traffic a lot better. The overall end user's experience is much better. They'll see faster speeds. It handles broadcast traffic much better than what you would see on Wave 2, 11AC Wave 2 or Wi-Fi 5.
So I received the recording to catch up. We will provide the recording after the webinar if you're missing,
Yeah, if you missed anything on the webinar, we'll have a recording after this session. I probably won't post until maybe Friday or Monday, but just be aware of that. I will cut out the Q&A section, so just so you know, so keep it as short as possible.